Well, my name's Adam Toos, and as director of the European Institute, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to this event tonight to celebrate the launch of Religion, Secularism, and Constitutional Democracy, a fabulously interesting collection of essays edited by Jean Cohen and Cecile Laborde. Apart from the involvement of the European Institute, we would like to thank, as co-sponsors of our event this evening, the Maison Française, obviously, Alliance, and the Institute for Religion, Culture, and Public Life, and Columbia University Press, who have the good fortune of having put the book out. The book is the product of sustained discussion and interaction, and I think it bears the hallmarks of that. This isn't just a collection of essays thrown together in a rush, it's obviously the product of sustained conversation. Two conferences sponsored by the European Institute, the Institute for Religion and Culture and Public Life, and the Alliance on the topic. The first was held at one of Columbia's global centres in Paris in 2012, and the second in New York in 2013. Now, I must say that as somebody whose personal identity, having read this text, I've come to understand as not so much post-Christian as post-post-Christian, who I think probably hoped that the issues of this book would never have to be discussed, and whose initial response is, oh, do we really have to? I'm nevertheless, as it were, persuaded as a historian, and by several of the wonderfully deep contributions here, by the thinness of secularism as it really exists in Europe. And of course, one can't read the newspapers today without being confronted by the fact that we simply can't evade this confrontation, the moment at which we might have responded to the efforts of radical Islam to force itself on our attention by simply shrugging, has clearly passed. And so if we have to have this conversation, then we just must hope that we can have it in the best possible intellectual company, in the most rigorous, most challenging, and most open-minded way. And for me, the pleasure of this book is that it promises precisely that. The contributors to the volume speak for themselves, as do our panellists this evening, who I'll briefly introduce. Jean will start things off. She is the Nell and Herbert Singer Professor of Political Theory and Contemporary Civilization at Columbia University, the author of many books, the most recent of which, Globalization and Sovereignty, Rethinking Legality, Legitimacy and Constitutionalism, of 2012. She will start our conversation this evening with a brief introduction on behalf both of herself and her co-editor, Cecile Laborde, who can't be with us tonight. Then the conversation will move on to Courtney Bender, to my right here, professor and chair in the Department of Religion. She, too, is the author of several books. She works mainly on the areas of social and cultural processes that shape religious practice in contemporary America. Her most recent book, or one amongst many, The New Metaphysical Spirituality in the American Religious Imagination, appeared in Chicago in 2010. Following Courtney will be Jeremy Kessler, Associate Professor of Law, whose work focuses on First Amendment law, administrative law, and constitutional law generally. His forthcoming book, Fortress of Liberty, The Rise and Fall of the Draft and the Remaking of American Law, explores how legal and political contests over the military draft in the US transform the relationship between civil liberties law and the American administrative machine. Jeremy will be followed by Ross Morris, Professor of Anthropology, immediately to my right here, whose fieldwork focuses on South Africa and Southeast Asia. She, too, the author of several scholarly monographs and critical essays based on a profound, deep anthropological fieldwork. Her writing also, however, includes fiction, poetry, libretti, and film scripts. And she writes frequently about the media and contemporary politics. Her recent books include a volume of conversations with the extraordinary South African artist and draftsman William Kentridge. And finally, last but by absolutely no means least, Gil Eyal, professor and chair of the Department of Sociology, whose work deals with the sociology of expertise, intellectuals, and knowledge. His latest book, The Autism Matrix, The Social Origins of the Autism Epidemic, Cambridge 2010, provides a sociological explanation for the current autism epidemic and traces the blurring of boundaries between experts and lay people that play a role in the dynamics of this epidemic. So please join me in welcoming our fantastic colleagues.
Thank you. First, I want to express my regret that my wonderful co-editor, Cecile Laborde, couldn't be here. She is French,
although she teaches at University College London, and has written brilliantly and critically about the French Republican model and the headscarf controversy. And I, an American, have been writing critically, at least, about current political and legal trends regarding religious freedom in the American constitutional model. So it's perfect to have this symposium at Columbia's Maison Française, for which I thank the directors. And I also want to thank all the contributors to this volume. Well, you actually thanked everybody else I wanted to thank. But I'm not sure you mentioned the Center for Democracy, Toleration, Religion was supported.
I missed that one.
That one. And I think the final conference, I can't remember, was actually in 2014 at Reed Hall in Paris, sponsored by everybody you mentioned, including Reed Hall and the office. And special thanks to Vicky DeGrazia, who was head of the Blinken Institute, now the European Institute, AKA goes in one of the situations. Anyway, so thanks to everybody for all their support. A problem with doing edited volumes is that by the time they appear, one has already moved on and learned new things. So with respect to at least my own piece in the volume, I would perhaps frame some things differently now. Yet the purpose of an edited volume is to formulate a problematic, to pose questions, issues, and important themes which hopefully will inspire further work by the contributors and future work by others. I made it clear in the text that what motivated me to put together a volume on religious secularism and constitutional democracy, focusing on consolidated Western democracies, is the following. For the quarter past century, Europe and the US have been riven by heated debates over religious freedom, secularism, and the appropriate roles of religion in public and political life. Ours is an age characterized by a remarkable religious revival and by the numerical increase of people who don't identify with any religion. By the way, the impulse for me was not the issue of Islam and Muslims in Europe. We're American, we don't have to go there, problem solved. Okay, gets point. It is also an epoch in which demands for religious freedom, state accommodation and recognition of religion on the one side, and for freedom from religion, from control by religious authorities, and from state enforcement of religious norms and privileges on the other, are proliferating and being politicized in myriad ways. Polarization between political religionists and militant secularists on both sides of the Atlantic is on the rise. Settled constitutional arrangements are being destabilized in regions that were the seedbed and locus classicus of political secularism and constitutional democracy, and the assumption that these must or even can go together is now questioned. Political religionists and post-secularists reject what they take to be characteristic of political secularism, the privatization of religion, and regard the principles of non-establishment and separation of church and state with suspicion. Secularists are equally suspicious of escalating demands for accommodation, multicultural jurisdiction, or religious status group legal pluralism involving immunity from the state's secular legal ordering, recognition of the right of religious groups to autonomously make their own law in key domains, always family law, but also sometimes education. And each side enlists the discourses of pluralism, human rights, fairness, constitutional principles, and sovereignty on their behalf. So the volume reflects anew on the meaning and modalities of religious freedom, secularism, and non-establishment that are compatible or required by basic liberal, republican, democratic principles. The questions are numerous, and the volume tries to address many of them. For example, what relation between non-establishment, separation of church and state, and freedom of religion is required by democratic constitutionalism? In what ways do they conflict, and how, if at all, do they presuppose each other? Is there a version of political secularism that can avoid the charges of bias? Can liberal democracy and human rights flourish without it? Do the presence of religious symbols and rituals in public and official spaces foster exclusion or inclusion of those who differ? Are religious justifications for public policy and law by public officials compatible with the core principles of democratic legitimacy and liberal principles of justice? Does the jurisdiction of religious authorities and tribunals over personal law or education expand or undermine human rights and civil, political, and gender equality of all citizens? In short, what arrangements will foster and expand rather than undermine the achievements of democratic constitutionalism domestically and transnationally? We are aware, we being the editors, that there are non-Western consolidated constitutional democracies. After all, Rajiv Bhargava, an eminent theorist of the Indian model of political secularism, is one of our contributors. But we had to narrow the field, and our aim is to trigger reflection on constitutional and political arrangements and theories in the region where political secularism first emerged. But it's clear to the editors of this volume that religion, secularism, liberalism, and republicanism are contested concepts and must be rethought so that standards can be developed for revising objectionable features of existing constitutional settlements in a normatively acceptable direction. Care should be taken that reform projects captured in the name of pluralism, fairness, or the right to religious freedom are not used to shield power, political, discriminatory, or anti-democratic projects. The editors concur on the basics. Here are the basics. Those dimensions of political secularism, full of what she calls it minimal secularism, that in the final analysis are constitutive of liberal constitutional democracy have to do with jurisdiction, justification, and civic responsibility. Differentiation among the institutions of religion and state, the comprehensiveness of the latter's jurisdiction and its supremacy, sovereignty, over the former is one feature of political secularism that we think is indispensable for liberal democracy. Democratic legitimacy resting on the authority of we the people, rather than on divine decrees or metasocial sources of law, is a normative driver here, and it's another constitutive feature of liberal democracy. The third, civic responsibility, has to do with the state's ultimate responsibility for the welfare of its citizens and for justice, regarding its own actions and actions of third parties on its territory. While the state can certainly delegate, for example, service delivery to non-public providers, religious or secular, it can't relinquish its ultimate answerability for the well-being of recipients, and it must set the standards and regulate all providers with an eye to liberal principles of justice, fairness, and non-discrimination. Freedom of association is a core liberal democratic principle that pertains equally to religious and non-religious groups, but the reflexive regulation of religious self-regulation by the democratic polity cannot be abdicated when it comes to core public purposes or basic human rights. Agreement on these essentials is much more of a debate about laws and public policies that civil constitutional democracies should pursue with regard to religious practice, state support, and regulation. And they point to a variety of secularisms, I borrow the term. While older models of establishment and non-establishment are being revised, the discourse of religion is also being interrogated, especially the assumption that religion is an unmitigated good and that it requires unique legal status in liberal constitutional democracies and human rights regimes. While the co-editors think that religion is special in relation to non-establishment, because the civil state is premised on a foundational distinction between the political and religious rule, just what kind of safeguards for and from religious organization and practice the liberal state must afford is a key issue. The editors are skeptical about whether religion is a unique good that should be construed as the first freedom in domestic constitutions or international human rights regimes. Indeed, several contributors wonder whether claims defended in the name of religious freedom could be as effectively protected and regulated through standard liberal rights. The idea is to de-reify the category of religion and disaggregate it, as LaBorde's term, so as to get at the core goods at stake: ethical integrity, cultural belonging, conscience, freedom of conscience, membership, collective expression, thus mainstreaming religious freedom so it's no longer construed as a distinct category under an exceptional legal regime. The book is divided into four parts. The first addresses the renewed political salience of the discourses of religious freedom, international human rights, and their interrelationship. There are essays by Sam Moyn and Phillips, Yasmin Ergas, Christian Jochka. Moyn offers a genealogy of the Christian activism behind inclusion, the inclusion of religious freedom as a human right in the European Convention, and its use first in anti-communist and now anti-Muslim decisions. Phillips and Ergas note the correlation between degrees of religiosity and gender inequality and the consequences of subordinating the human rights of women to corporate religious power. Both address conflicts of rights and dilemmas of various reform strategies from this perspective. Jochka, like Moyn, analyzes the discriminatory jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights, regarding Muslims, and asked whether there is something special about Islam that renders it incompatible with liberalism, answering in the negative and rejecting the militant secularist politics. Part two returns to the relation between political secularism, non-establishment, and liberal democratic constitutionalism. Liberalism is indeterminate when it comes to the question of whether impartiality requires non-establishment or multiple establishments, meaning official recognition and even funding of all religions. Essays by myself, Rajiv Bargava, Tariq Mondoud, Denis Lacan, and Claudia Haupt engage with these issues. I develop an ideal type of political secularism, counterposed to theocracy on the one side, establishment on the other, and I trace shifts in discourses of separation and accommodation in the American model since the 1990s, arguing for a reflexive law approach to state regulation of religious self-regulation, one that doesn't throw out the non-establishment baby with the strict separationist bathwater, or treat religion as so special and unique that accommodation becomes tantamount to abdication of sovereignty and responsibility by the democratic polity to ensure that principles of justice protect all of us. Bargava, on whom I draw, and Mondoud engaged in a debate over the relative merits of non versus multiple establishments generally and with respect to Europe. Cohen traces some of the shifts in the politicization of religion in the US to the southern strategy of the Republican Party. And Claudia Haupt reflects on whether a transnational European, whether a transnational non-establishment principle may be emerging in Europe through the discourse of neutrality, despite deference to member states' formal and de facto establishments, reminding us that the US Constitution didn't rule out state establishments until the mid-20th century. If she and Lacorne are right, while religious pluralism may no longer be doing the work of fostering a robust conception of non-establishment in the US, it may be doing just that in Europe, even without the term. The chapters in part three address the philosophical and normative questions posed by public and political religion for liberal constitutional democracies. The essays by Laborde, Bardon, and Invernizzi each try to identify which structural features of religious arguments conflict with liberal democratic republican principles and which don't. Laborde argues that liberal democrats should bite the bullet and own the secular language of politics and institutions their commitments presuppose. They're not neutral with their own liberal commitments and shouldn't be. Her conclusion comports with some of Cohen's, that's me, and Bargava's analysis of political secularism. Bardon and Invernizzi concur that is ultimately the absolutist dimension of justifications of public policy ascribed to external, authoritative, or with a sources exogenous to we people that are incompatible with imminent democratic forms of justification of law and public policy by officials. And Tropea concurs and makes an argument for the supremacy of civil republican legal sovereignty to ensure the compatibility of religious associations' rules with civil law. The last section on sovereignty and legal pluralism has essays by Yuta Grimm, Malia Malik, Linda McLean, and Alicia Sabata Romero, each of which reflects on whether religious status group legal pluralism, so called as multicultural jurisdiction, is the appropriate way to respond to the fact of deep religious diversity in established Western democracy. Even if in the short run, it works against distrust among different religious groups and secular citizens, what is the cost regarding individual freedom and equality, and who pays the price? It's well known that religious status group legal pluralism was invented as an administrative strategy in empire, generating tolerance but also based on hierarchy and inequality. It's also true that in our own epoch, deeply divided societies transitioning from authoritarianism or civil war instituted religious, cultural, and tribal status group legal pluralism, particularly with regard to family law and what became stable constitutional democracy, India, South Africa, Israel. But this occurred in context of civil war, in which context of civil war was real or an imminent threat, in which armed groups divided along rigid religious, ethnocultural lines and had to report to the civil polity, or in which state and nation building took place in deeply divided society. It's also true that the price has been very high from the perspective of gender equality and other human rights and justice issues. The various essays in this session contend with this issue. So there's a lot to discuss, and I want to turn this over to the commentators. And I think I'll just do that.
Okay. So my first remark will immediately, I think, reveal some disciplinary differences that are in my case, relative disciplinary ignorance. I really found this to be a fantastic collection, not that Courtney doesn't find it to be a fantastic collection, but fantastic specifically in, I don't know of another collection of its kind that does as well in combining comparative sweep, social theory, political theory, religious studies, and most rarely a truly careful and learned analysis of various legal regimes. Now, I will now caveat that first remark on the religious studies. I was just floored by its scope and its depth. What I'm going to do in my remarks is first I want to praise and commend the analysis offered in Jean Cohen's marvelous chapter on political secularism and the American model of constitutional dualism. I think it is a really important intervention into the American debate, both as a matter of law, politics, and history. I then am going to query some of Jean's analysis in that chapter to raise two larger questions, both that I think both apply to the American case studies in the book, as well as the book as a whole. And those two questions I'll just say at the outset so you're not held in suspense are, A, one, what does Jean's analysis of liberal constitutional democracy and religion tell us about the nature of the state in liberal constitutional democracy? And second is, what does this analysis tell us about the relationship between religion and the economy? And this may be more Gill's terrain than mine, but this is where I'll register the classic scholarly annoyance and an absence. I did find it striking that the word economy does not occur in the book, nor does the word capitalism, which seemed to me not fatal omissions, but fascinating ones.
Corporate
is definitely there, and I'll talk about that. I'll talk about that a bit. So first, to Jean's analysis. I think what Jean has done both in her introduction and in her chapter, and I think it's echoed by Cecile Laborde to a great extent in the conclusion, is center the analysis on an astute assertion, a very strong assertion that I think is one we have to deal with. And that is that strict separationism between religion and state in modern liberal constitutional democracies is, quote, incoherent because the modern state, qua sovereign, has legal supremacy and a monopoly over publicly enforceable coercive law, end quote, and, quote, unilaterally determines the relative autonomy, degree of self-regulation, and acceptable practices of religious organizations. Nor can a liberal democratic constitutional state avoid regulating religion. And that argument about the incoherence of strict separationism, I then really think drives what is a very perceptive analysis of contemporary American constitutional law, politics, and religion. And where it brings Jean is to an argument that I think Cecile Laborde summarizes very concisely, and I think you agree with it, which is that Jean concludes as to America and in general, that there is no reason to think that religious associations should be especially favored or burdened under the law of association. Instead, they should be funded and regulated on the same basis as non-religious associations. That's obviously true in many countries, not currently true in America. While this would expand the scope of state funding for secular activities carried out by churches, it would also tighten the degree of scrutiny religious associations are subjected to. In particular, it would not immunize them from the scrutiny of anti-discrimination laws. So what Jean proposes is a model of what she calls reflexive regulation, in which by understanding the fact that the liberal constitutional democracy in effect constitutes religious organization, that it can safely treat with religious organization, and that in a modern welfare state it has to. That public provision can be provided to religious and non-religious organizations alike. There is no need for the excessive fears of entanglement that motivated some mid-century American jurisprudence. But this equal funding of religious and non-religious associations, this equal engagement of the state with religious and non-religious associations, comes with a very high but necessary cost, which is the absolute non-immunity of religious organizations from those sorts of regulation that are crucial to maintaining a homogeneous liberal democratic polity. Homogeneous, not in a strong anti-pluralistic sense, but in the sense that there is a basic minimum that applies to all individuals within the state. So I think that's a fascinating model and a fascinating recommendation for a direction in which American law could go that should be taken seriously by jurists, politicians, scholars, and religious actors. It does then raise these two larger questions. Adam, how am I doing on time?
4 or 5 minutes.
Great. And I can do that. Okay, so the first question is, what does this account tell us about the nature of the state as such in liberal constitutional democracies? Now, in addressing the relationship between the state and religion, which is the subject of this book and Jean's essay, Jean uses very strong language that I've already quoted. The state unilaterally determines the relative autonomy, degree of self-regulation, and acceptable practices of religious organizations. Now, this made me ask the following. Do the set of liberal constitutional democratic theorists who would agree with Jean's statement there, vis-a-vis religion, do they actually agree with that characterization of the state when it comes to other aspects of civil society? I find in that characterization of the state a very powerful, what you might call constructivist bent. The idea that, from the law school you might call it a legal realist bent. The idea that the state, that state power, is that which in essence constitutes civil society, does not determine every aspect of civil society, but constitutes its basic forms, modes of associating, structures, modes of relating between citizens. I don't generally hear liberal theorists embracing that account of the relationship between state and civil society. Although here it does seem to be embraced vis-a-vis religion, so I would be curious as to whether Jean would be willing to extend it to a more general critique of the state's and civil society divide that we so often see in liberal political and legal theory. The second question is about the relationship between religion and economy. Now, as I mentioned, although economy is central to the book, and particularly to Jean's chapter, The American Case Studies, in the sense that the controversial cases that are driving the analysis are these cases in which businesses, for-profit businesses, have been accorded religious exemptions. So business is there. But that seems to me to demand a further inquiry along the following lines, and then I'll stop. In, I think, a variety of traditions of social theory, whether you look to Max Weber or Karl Polanyi or Marx, civil society is that place where one finds both religion and the market, both religion and business. In Marx's famous controversial essay on the Jewish question, the argument is put forward that this central differentiation between the state and civil society, the state is over here, and then civil society is over here, and contains both the market, the economy, and religion. Marx argues that that pairing of religion and economy, with specific reference to the American case in the 1840s, immediately after the disestablishment of the state churches, is indicative of mature capitalism. So this, to me, raises the question of whether if the worry, which Jean presents as the worry, of these religious organizations sort of making greater and greater claims on the state is the opposite. You know, is that's the threat, is the idea of theocratic, is the idea of theocratic government. Is this also a story in America today of seeing the market as such seizing public power, right? So the worry about the business or the religious businesses getting religious rights is that they are moving from civil society into the state, and to sort of taking some part of the commanding heights of the state. Would that analysis be extended to the businesses as such? Is this part of a larger phenomenon in which that distinction between we are seeing the sort of melting away of that supposed distinction between civil society and the state, both in terms of religion and in terms of the market?
First of all, thank you to Jean, both for the excellence of the collection and of the scrupulous editorial work that went into this, and for the invitation to participate in a conversation for which I am completely unqualified. And my greatest gratitude is, of course, that in reading the book and in listening here, I learned a lot. And so I will speak from a position of utter ignorance, but being an anthropologist, I will start with anecdote to sort of cover them up. Two anecdotes, I think, that are interesting to bear in mind from parts of the world in which I have some experience. And I'll preface this by saying that both in your introduction, actually in three cases, in your introduction this evening, in the introduction to the text, and in your own essay, you emphasize the exceptionality of those situations in which the demand for legal pluralism, particularly vis-a-vis the protection of religious status groups, arises in situations of violent conflict, post-transition, or whatever, under duress and in exceptional circumstances. And I think on the one hand that's true, and on the other hand, you answered your own question when you said, you know, the history of the empire must be figured in this. If one thinks of Siam, later Thailand, in the 19th century, the first provisions for any protection of religious freedom came about after a petition on the part, essentially, of English merchants and American missionaries for extraterritorial exemption from the relatively local Siamese monarchy at that time, relatively not very powerful monarch at the time. That was granted. But it was essentially an alibi for getting extraterritorial rights for merchants who were seeking exemption from local taxation and so forth. By the end of within the last 10 years, after the resacralization of the Siamese monarchy, thanks to constitutional labors that inscribed within that constitution a new basis for the monarchy's exemption from constitutional law, such that the translation of the last constitution from Thailand had to be revised after it was mistakenly said that in English it should be represented as a constitutional democracy. It was revised as an electoral democracy with the king as head of state. That country imagines itself to provide protection for religious minorities and, of course, is the site of an extremely inequitable distribution of protections under the law and a fairly systematic discriminatory policy vis-a-vis minoritized Muslims. Across the border, at the same time, the British, not seeking colonial, not seeking a territorialized colonial rule in the area of Siam, sought it in what became British Malaya, and effected the kind of pluralism that we associate with indirect rule. That is, it devolved civil and family law to religious authorities, primarily Muslim clerics, in very local ways. That state now constitutes one of the sites of some of the most discriminatory practice in mainland Southeast Asia, but under the influence largely of Saudi Wahhabi capital. I raise these two, on one hand, territorialized but extraterritorial pluralism, and on the other hand, a multicultural pluralism, but in the interest of territorialized colonial governance, just to basically recognize, actually to affirm the claims made in this book, that if one could borrow or channel Luce Irigaray, who would definitely not be in this conversation, this secularism is not one. It's empirically diverse in the history of its conceptualization. It's internally divided. I'm going to return to the South African case later. I'm going to try and bounce off a little bit both of the previous two comments and maybe land somewhere in the middle. In the disciplines where I hang out, anthropology, philosophical, and literary criticism, it has become axiomatic to assert the political, theological underpinnings and logics of those Western political systems that otherwise write themselves under the sign of secularism. This axiom is often thoughtfully argued, but when reduced to an accusation, it takes the form of saying that secularism is Protestant Christianity in drag, a form of moque premised on the possibility of privatizing religion and the valorization of the voluntarist self-same subject. This subject, even when devout, engages in the public sphere as the proper bearer of self-interest, and does so because he or she is able to suspend his or her commitment to particular narratives of the intuition of the transcendental. The critics of this position have a great deal of historical evidence, that is the fantasy that one can have a secularity based on the privatization of faith. The critics of this position have a great deal of historical evidence on their side, but they often engage in a kind of legitimation by reversal, asserting that non-Protestant religions, and especially Islam, are immune to this separation. They often also avow the affective and socially satisfying dimensions of public praxis, particularly for those whom Protestant Christianity would presumably imagine to be oppressed and in need of protection. And while holding Kant culpable, they buy into a more Rawlsian idealism wherein religion is thought of as a conception of the good. They buy, in other words, the ideology of the secularism they would disavow, ignoring heresy and also pietism and evangelicalism in the Christian traditions, and believing that Protestants are somehow, or at least imagine themselves to be, or think it would be good to be, disembodied heads in the clouded domain of private faith. I don't think that's an accurate representation of how most even Protestants think of their faith. They thus leave over beyond the scope of their considerations, or in addition, they leave beyond the scope of their considerations the twin dimensions of capital, which James already raised this, and I'm going to come back to it in a different way. They leave beyond the scope of their consideration the twin dimensions of capital and ideology on one hand, the subjectification of individuals for capital in and through sexual difference on the other. I'm going to have a little more to say about the latter in a second, realizing that translation is now a problem. One of the virtues of the collection is its aim to stage the problem of the relation between secularism and religion as they are conceived of within law and by the proponents of one or another position for constitutional democracies in systematic and taxonomically rigorous manner, with remarkable thoroughness and, I think, great pragmatic self-limitation. And there's a concision in the text that's laudable, even if on occasion it leaves one wanting sometimes somewhat
textured readings of some of the particular cases. There's no doubt about the project here, and that is the imagination of ways to shore up robust constitutional democracies in the face of what ails them. From what threatens the state understood to be imminently and reflexively democratic, as well as the substantive principles of formal equality, the rule of law, and I'm going to emphasize the formal equality and the rule of law. Jean puts it very strongly in her contribution in the volume. Given this, you know, just naked avowal of this project, defend constitutional liberal democracies from what ails them, and it's probably called religion, but in a minute, which of course made me say, yes, I'll join you in this conversation. Given this framework, there are actually abundant surprises, not least being that the accommodation that is both described and avowed here throughout. And occasionally that accommodationism seems to be the product of a kind of pragmatic resignation and comes with an affect of melancholy. It might be just mine. I think it's emerging. But also, and not infrequently, it's quite exuberantly avowed. The surprises or the sand in the machine of caricature, of which I am also guilty, but that's the nature of a short presentation, are often historical. This is the case in Samuel Moyne's account of the case history of the European Court of Human Rights since World War II, and the revelation that the impetus for the apparently secularist human rights declarations and conventions of the UN and the EU respectively was not the repression of religion, but the protection of Christianity, especially Catholic Christianity, from the feared godlessness of the socialist bloc. Some of the surprises emerge as a result of the accumulating evidence of the multiplicity of forms of relation between ostensibly secular states and the churches or religion, and there's some discussion in the text about what we really are talking about, what are the institutional, organizational forms. What's the relation between ostensibly secular states and the churches with which they share or compete for power, just with which they share and among which they distribute jurisdiction, regulating in negative and positive ways their members, depending on the location at which those members confront the regulatory regimes that indeed come to bear upon them. The differences are differently understood in terms of their historical emergence and structural logic. There's a zero papism versus theocracy in the case of integration. There's separation of one sort, pluralism of another. There are many typologizations, these on the basis of both formal and substantive principles. And there are differences in terms of geographic distribution and the principle of territoriality and its relative significance for the concept of jurisdiction among the many things that are accomplished in the text. By and large, the volume, as you've already heard, is concerned with Europe and the U.S., passing reference to India, the millet system of the Ottoman Empire, and so forth. Many of the essays are oriented around the obvious and carefully analyzed symmetry between the ways that Islamic and Christian cases to the European courts have, I should say, asymmetry. Asymmetry, that's wish fulfillment, right? In the ways that Islamic and Christian cases to the European courts have been dealt with in Europe or made the basis of paranoid legislation in the U.S., such as the anti-Sharia fantasies that operate in many U.S. states. What's clear from these essays is that the question of political theology, which rightly displaces the ideal typical image of perfect separation, at the level of logic, or as the case may be, a-logic, but which then cannot differentiate forms of proximity and entanglement at the institutional level, where, as one says, people's lives are shaped. So I want to turn now to a meta-question concerning the work that the word religion does here, but from a very different perspective than Courtney does. I'm not going to talk forever, I promise. There is at least passing acknowledgement among most of the authors that the term religion is a dubious moniker under which a variety of practical, institutional, ideational, and subjective assemblages, for lack of a better word, are given the false appearance not of a substantive content but of a commensurability. And it is absolutely necessary that the category be empty if the commensuration is to be performed. So the fact that they're not detailed descriptions of the internal content theological principles or even practical repertoires make sense given the project of this text, I think. Many of the essayists respond with an effort to refine the definition of the English word and insists on its function for normative projects. So I think we don't need to worry about whether we can fix the category of religion through renomination, historically or empirically. And it's not a naive collection in that regard, and nor is it disingenuous. In this book, the secularist project is uniformly understood to be one premised on the substantive value of equality and the necessity of both protecting and promoting that value, even if, in Rajiv Bhargava's essay, the question is put in an astonishingly naked form. In an effort to differentiate positive, in the form of direct and indirect aid, from negative, regulatory intervention, prohibition, and violent enforcement, Bhargava writes, suppose that the value to be advanced is social equality. I mean, this is kind of in the middle of the book, this is what, and what else would it be, is the one question, yet it's really interesting where that occurs in the text. Not incidentally, this pivot or hinge in his text is the point at which the issue of child marriage and untouchability, gender and caste, arise. Indeed, this is always the hinge, where the secularist hypothesis demands refinement, whether accommodationist or integrationist in whatever form, is exactly where the question of sexual difference arises. And this is because, of course, and now here I have to just indulge anthropology for a second, this is because among the many things that religion is, it is a mythopoetic and institutional system within which sexual difference becomes the ground for narrating and norming inequality, above all by making sexual difference stand as a special and primal instance of difference to co. If this were a mere mythopoesis, we could say, nice, interesting, fabulous for close reading, but who cares? But if we understand religion in terms of the binarity of the secularist word game, i.e., religion only emerges in terms of that word game in relationship to the political. If we understand religion in terms of the binarity of the secularist word game, we have to understand that it is a set of institutions, this is what the book is about, which perform social functions in the space of capital, globalized capital today, especially the provision of health and educational services, but also the operation of penal and mediatic services. And merely to call them service is already to engage in the masquerade by which the pursuit of profit hides itself, and of course with it the valorization of that structure of value that makes such profit possible. As such, if it's just capital, it's not special, doesn't need special protections. Fine. As mythopoetic system, all religions are alike, but not the same, but still not special. But of course they are felt to be special. I mean, this is what the book responds to, that threat which animates it, which animates us, which animates everyone on either side of the integrationist or separatist divide. In their concatenation, they become special because they are sites at which subjects are produced and not merely regulated, subordinated, enabled, or disabled in terms of their access to rights understood in the model of a commodity. And I think this would be the next question that I would urge to be posed. It's where I think all of the struggles right now, for example, in South Africa, where a very powerful effort was made to embrace a pluralist understanding, is falling apart around the question of education as much, because it is there that family law questions of the subject and also around come together. It is because they are sites up for the production of subjects and not simply forms of access to capital or distribution of corporate privilege and so forth that we care about them. And this strikes me as so profound a question and demanding of such an honest exploration that I hope the next book goes there.
Okay, finish, and actually take some from where you ended up, I think. So one of the questions posed by this volume is there a version of political secularism that can avoid the challenges of bias and one-sidedness leveled by religions? My gut reaction is that the answer to this question is no. Now, to be clear, I'm quite sure that people, religious and secular, are always going to complain and cry foul, especially in a liberal democracy, but that's not really why my gut reaction is no. My gut reaction is sort of rebellion. This is an antinomy, an irreconcilable conflict of values that is not going to go away. Nothing makes it clearer than the fact that both sides use the same language of human rights, pluralism, tolerance, non-discrimination, and freedom to justify diametrically opposed position. The language itself is shot with constitutive contradictions. This has been evident for a long time now in the abortion debate. Yes, one side talks about life, the other talks about choice, but they both speak the common language of the dignity of the human person. As Krista Luca has demonstrated almost 3 decades ago, the debate is about the relative worth of persons, and the language of right is not only ill-suited to resolve it, it also engages in a certain doublespeak. In our society, persons are supposed to have exactly the same worth. To be a person is to have an indivisible quantum of worth exactly equal to any other person. But in reality, we constantly measure the relative worth of beings and hierarchize them. Now, I'm painfully aware that to the legal ear, the comments sound altogether naive, stating the obvious, avoiding the task. Conflicts of value and contradictions, after all, the bread and butter of legal scholars and judges. As former Justice Dieter Green says in this volume, most of the problem posed by the conflict between religious values and the sovereignty of the secular constitutional state could be solved by balancing, as he puts it. Which interests weigh heavier, in what situations, what would be a justifiably proportionate limitation of a fundamental right. But I'm not a legal scholar, I'm a sociologist. I have enormous respect for the work of balancing and commensuration that is performed by judges, but I have a different job. Balancing and commensuration, by definition, require a certain hermeneutic poverty. Devising the common scales on which the two sides could balance inevitably requires a certain deference to the radical terms in which they state their differences. The sociologist, on the other hand, must practice value relevance, must be attuned to the distinctive meanings that animate the dispute. So to do so, the sociologist must take the dangerous expedient of constructing not scales on which to balance the two sides' claims, but the common terrain in which the battle is joined. I say dangerous because it inevitably requires us not to give the sovereign state a privileged status outside the dispute, but must count it among the interested one-sided contestants. This is, as is very clear in Green's chapter, or in Michel Tropel's positivist analysis of French law, in judicial reasoning, the state is at once a side in the dispute and the scales themselves. Even the most wide-ranging forms of legal pluralism are anchored in an act of self-limitation by the state, he says, which retains the rights to revoke the authorization or condition them. So I'm conscious that I'm straying very close to this danger, that the place where secularism is constructed as a form of anti-religious bias, and secular liberal state is no longer neutral. Hopefully I can turn back from the precipice, you will be the judge. So let me suggest this image, and I know it's going to land me in hot water. 30 years ago, the late Charles Steele described the rise of the state from among other network of offering protection services. The state, said Steele, emerged as a protection racket. The exchange was protection for taxes. And ultimately, it requires a monopoly over the means of violence, promotion of capital accumulation, and the creation of a centralized, autonomous, extensive political organization in the nation states. As an instructive aside, I should say that when I wanted to refresh my memory and find this article again and typed it into the web, I found it on www.jesusradicals.com, which I know is landing in a worse hand. Okay, so it's possible to look at the state's relationship to religion somewhat similarly. The competition was not about protection, but about controlling the supply and the supply of and the demand for salvation goods and services. By salvation.
Salvation.
I mean the...
Yes,
capitalism. I mean, though, by salvation, I mean what Weber meant in this term, which is meaning, ultimate values, answers to some of the most profound questions of human existence. Who am I? Why am I here upon this earth? Why are there injustice, suffering, death, and pain? How should I act? And to the extent that these answers do not remain merely a doctrine, but also are bound up with pastoral practice, which administers to the everyday needs of the laity. The exchange is not for taxes, despite the obvious interest also in dues, indulgences, donations, wives, church taxes, and exemptions. The exchange is for obedience, an obedience that is owed to the sacred, but ultimately to the pastors that provide this worldly and otherworldly salvation goods. Enormous amount of power could be mobilized if you are able to provide people with a satisfying answer to who they are. We all want to know who we are. We are intensely interested in this question, and hardly anybody can remain indifferent to it. A satisfying answer to this question, however, typically entails a whole economy of worth, a hierarchy of who is more worthy and who less and why. Now, as Tilly knew well enough, the modern nation state emerged not only out of a generalized competition for the protection tax exchange, but also as a set of winning strategies out of the competition to control the salvation obedience exchange. State actors articulated forms of pastoral power, sometimes against religious pastors, many times in alliance with them, but even the most secular state was never neutral. It always sought to anchor state power and legitimacy in the salvation obedience exchange. Let me mention just two obvious examples. One is nationalism. I mean, obviously, the protection tax exchange would never by itself have been able to forge nation states. Nationalism has been called a secular religion for good reasons, but often it's not even secular at all, but incorporates a distinctive religious dimension. Now, I am Israeli, you can tell by my accent, but Israel is not unique in this matter, yeah? English nationalism was had a profoundly religious vision of national mission. There's Hindu nationalism, there's Russian Orthodox nationalism, etc., etc. Nationalism is about salvation. It's about answers to questions like, who am I? And about the ultimate purpose of our presence on this earth, like manifest destiny and national glory. It tells us what to do. It arises beings and persons on a sliding scale of worth. Okay. You would be right to say that these forms of nationalism are more often than not really liberal. So they're irrelevant to the original question about liberal constitutional democracy. But liberalism as well incorporates a distinctive pastoral dimension. I don't need to go to the postmodern analysis. I can just go back to Durkheim and to his brilliant analysis of the French liberalism of his day, which he analyzed as the cult of the individual. At the heart of this cult, he says, is the idea of the dignity of the human person. To quote Durkheim, and this was a zealot defender of secular democracy as there ever was, this ideal, the dignity of the human person, so far surpasses the level of utilitarian goals that it seems to those minds who aspire to it to be completely stamped with religiosity. This human person, the definition of which is like a touchstone which distinguishes good from evil, is considered sacred in the ritual sense of the word. It partakes of the transcendent majesty that churches of all time lend to their gods. It is conceived as a being invested with that mysterious property which creates a void about sacred things, which removes them from vulgar contacts and withdraws them from common circulation. And Durkheim goes on to note that the dignity of the human person is a paradoxical notion, an antinomy, one would say, because at one and the same time it implies that it has nothing to do with the personal characteristics of the individual. We say that the dignity of even the worst criminal has to be protected. And yet, we cannot quite treat it in an abstract and general way. The dignity of the individual is a general quality that all individuals share, their humanity, but only by virtue of being individualized in a very specific way in each of them. Durkheim makes clear that the structure of this ideal, the way it reconciles the antinomy of the general and the particular, is essentially identical to the religious notion of the soul. book and text, is important to note, was written as an intervention in the Dreyfus affair. It was his way of dealing with the Dreyfus affair. So it should be read not as capturing the essence of liberalism, but as a political strategy of the Third Republic to constitute itself as a civil religion, to use a term that Robert Bella also used in the American case to describe a somewhat similar strategy. Now, this was always understood as militant secularism, and perhaps in the French case, there's good reasons why. But perhaps we could also understand it as complementary with the religious strategy described by Sam Moyn in this chapter. With Vatican II, dignity of the human person becomes the linchpin for an alliance in which religious freedom, pluralism, and human rights are synonymous with a Christian Europe, as made clear also in Yorke's chapter. Just like nationalism, liberalism too can incorporate a quasi-religious dimension in which salvation, the sacredness of the individual, is exchanged for obedience. So where does this analysis leave us and what to do? I think the value of the sociological analysis is limited, but its value is that it focuses not on religious groups, that term that is sort of a black box, but on the pastors, namely on the various actors, among them both religious functionaries but also state officials, vying for control over the laity. A liberal strategy should not try to ignore this competition between pastors, but on the contrary, in the best tradition of neoliberalism, should encourage forms of regulated competition and harness it for its purposes. It may not be possible for the liberal state to avoid the accusation of bias, but it should be possible to draw the religious functionaries into a form of regulated competition that acts to co-opt and moderate them, rather than exclude and radicalize them. Here I draw on the argument and examples provided by Malik in her truly useful chapter on minority legal orders. And I'll conclude with two arguments from this chapter. One, minority legal orders are not just alternative community norms relying on informal social pressure. At the minimum, they should involve an institutional mechanism for exercising authority through decisions, interpretation, and implementation. Put differently, the liberal state has everything to gain from organizing its competitors because, this is elementary Weberian sociology, the character of the pastors thereby changes from angry prophets to religious functionaries with a stake in the existing order. Second point, such minority legal orders operate best in the framework of what Malik calls cultural voluntarism, and I would call a well-regulated market. It means that in several strategic spheres, individuals have the right to move at will between the minority legal order and the state legal order. In this way, you bring the forces of demand to bear on the pastors, and you prevent that defensive reaction in which, because of the sense of threat, minority social and religious norms ossify into fixed, uncompromising rules. Instead, regulated competition with the state system, together with the forces of demand, can co-opt the religious functionaries and encourage them to develop a more flexible jurisprudence that allows minority legal order to respond to new social conditions and to become a dynamic tradition.
Thank you. Well, watching Eugene, it'd be cruel to deny you the chance to respond to the panel, much as we would like to bring the audience in. So I think you should, and briefly perhaps, and then we'll very open the floor, and then we'll have another round of responses from.
So I'll do it. Is this on? Can you hear me? Yeah, so I'll do it in reverse order, so let's get this. But I wonder whether you just described Israel. I'm not sure, but if you did,
I wish.
No, because it doesn't make a strong case for what you argue for, because in fact, Israel is a state of multicultural jurisdiction. It does organize the pastors, as it were.
It doesn't have cultural voluntarism. It doesn't have the
voluntary. Wait, I know, I was going to get there. Wait, so it does organize the 16 millets that it has. It's correct, it does not offer a uniform civil code as an alternative, but then you'd end up with Ayelet Shachar's position, which I've criticized elsewhere, so it's maybe this is too much of an internal debate, but I wouldn't go there. I mean, it seems that if you're saying, certainly in Israel, you certainly think having a uniform civil code, in other words, for family law would be a huge step forward. I would not argue against that, but then I think the kind of status with religious status for political pluralism, the meneses of that has very, very, I have a very dim view of it. And many others, especially concerned with gender equality, have a similar dim view. In fact, I refer you to the book of, I'll never pronounce this correctly, it's a Turkish name, Yüksel Seçen, I'm sure I'm massacring the name, but it's a book that studies the effects of this kind of religious legal pluralism in three countries, Egypt, Israel, and India, on many sets of, on several sets of human rights, not only the issues of gender equality, and it doesn't look good. And some of them, and India has, well, no, let's see. No, it doesn't have uniform civil code, but in any case. I suspect that the debates will go on, and let me just make a general point about the political secularism that refers to, I think, Courtney and Gail. No, it's not correct. The book is not on the ground of comprehensive, does not stand on the ground of comprehensive secularism against which the arguments are made. That's not right. Actually, some of us go to great lengths to try and differentiate between political secularism, probably not kind of all the same thing, but political secularism and comprehensive secularism. For example, Cecile Laborde's book, her book on critical republicanism, criticizes what she does see as the comprehensive secularism of the French Republican model. So that there are very careful attempts to show that this is not the ground that it stands on. Commitment to the principles, I use the word liberal as a code, but I mean the egalitarian principles, etc., of liberal constitutional democracy. Is not identical, at least not for me, to buying into a comprehensive secularism that is a fundamentalist worldview, as are those sins to which the country goes. So that's of course, I don't agree with that, the elision of these distinctions. Now, political secularism itself is contested, sure, but everything's contested. Now, to get to the issues of, I'll just say something about what Ross said, insofar as I understood it. I agree with quite a lot of it, and I do think, and this doesn't come out in this volume, that that religion and other things, certainly not only religion, do constitute, that's one of the crucial, absolutely central issues, is about the sites where subjects are produced and struggle for control over those sites, and education is at the core of the question. So obviously, the screaming little monster is born and raised, and by chance one ended up in a Muslim family, one ended up in a Jewish family, whatever. But then the question is about the schooling beyond that and control of schooling. None of us get into this in this volume, but I think this is absolutely crucial, and I put my cards on the table from a critical Republican standpoint. I think it's I would be very happy if we had only an exclusively public school. I mean, no private schools at all. Not for the rich, not for anybody else. I suspect our public schools would be a lot better if we did. But that doesn't mean you can't have debate and disagreement, and contestation within the school, but anyway. So that's what I would say to Roz's point. Now, as for the questions that pertain to the state that Jill raised and Jeremy raised, I laugh because I'm actually I have some major books and my co-authors there on civil society and political theory. And in the past, they're always misconstrued as arguing for civil society without the state, almost in a quasi-anarchist position, which we never shared. And then the slogan is no state, no civil society. You can't have one without the other. And now it looks like I'm a rabid statist. And actually, I have another piece coming out on sovereignty. and it, within this constellation, I have a whole book on polemics with somebody, but a book on somebody. So the question is, so the point is this. We purposely talked about, I know, let's just not get nervous about the word liberal, but say liberal democratic constitutional republics, okay? And from the perspective of the concept of democracy, popular sovereignty, however you would construe this, basically the idea is that, don't get distracted by the word state. Think just democratic polity, okay? It can be a city, it can be a state, it can be a supranational entity, etc. From the perspective of a democratic polity, what is compatible or incompatible with that kind of arrangement? So, sure, the state, I mean, you know, I think the Tilly analysis of the state is somewhat one-sided, but, and what I take seriously is, once these states were formed, the attempts to transform them. So, there were things called the democratic revolutions, there were projects for the rule of law, liberal rights, etc. I don't know what else you think is out there that we can have as an alternative. If you look at areas of failed states, it doesn't look good. Of course, I'm not talking about other political attractive alternatives, for example, federations. And one can discuss how territorial they are or not. The United States is a territorial state. Europe, heaven knows what that's going to be. There are some issues there. But in any case, I'm not holding on to, in a rigid way, the territorial nation state of the, let's say, 19th century Westphalian model. Not at all. But I am insisting on the role of, on the idea of public power, public responsibility. And in that sense, unilateral in the sense that law, it, unlike, let's say, what used to be called the Ständestaat, I don't know how to translate that in English, so the state of states, of you know, between the medieval and the modern period, where you had a multiplicity of basically hybrid powers, quasi-public, quasi-private, none of which were democratic, bargaining with each other over rules and laws. When I say unilateral, it's simply, it's just a something. Don't get nervous about it. It's just a legal, it's just a statement that once you transition to the modern state, and then the modern liberal democratic state, when the laws are passed, presumably by democratic parliaments or whatever, and all kinds of pressures and negotiations. Once these laws are passed, you then don't have to negotiate with some other group or entity that has power with which you say, well, I'll agree or I won't agree. That's what the conception of modern law is. And the idea is that I do think that some of the strategies of certain discourses of religious status quo, legal pluralism that frame religions as sovereigns, for example, that's exactly what they're trying to get back and bring this back to. And in fact, some of the literature that I address in a later piece is precisely an attempt to criticize so-called monistic sovereignty of the United States, for example, monistic sovereignty of the state in favor of the plurality of sovereignty that you had with the Papal Revolution, etc., and to argue for the sovereignty of the corporate religious, the word corporate we have to discuss. So that's, I think, one of the challenges, and it's serious, and it is proliferating. And so, no, it's not that the state creates groups. I can say it's a civil society person. It doesn't create all the groups. And you know there's enormous debate about the corporate. Is it real? Should the state, this is used in these debates. Is the corporation just a creature of the state, or is the corporation a real entity that preceded, that the state should just somehow acknowledge? And I'm not going to get into that debate now, but it's being resurrected not only by those in economics and who want corporate power for business, but also in the religious field. And the issue, rather, is, look, if we're in a context, hopefully we can make the democratic state more democratic, better, more liberal if we want it in the right way, more social democratic, however you want to put it. Or we could have a supranational, let's say, regional polity that would fit, that would not lose each other to democratic constitutionalism. I don't care how you set it up. But the real point is that whatever other powers there are, and there are other powers, autonomous groups, obviously, you know, religious groups form themselves. The state doesn't create them, for the sex. And nor does the state attempt to answer the ultimate questions of life. I don't agree with that statement. Nationalism doesn't ask the ultimate questions of life, for example, what happens after I die? No answer. In any case, I would say that the importance of the supremacy of state law, the law of the democratic popular sovereign, if we could get it in the best form possible, right? And it's never the best form. That at least there you can contest, you insist on accountability, you insist on voice, etc. These organizations, at least that's supposed, and then you can you can change policy, but there at least I would say that public power has to have the supremacy over whatever, of course, given freedom of association, over whatever prerogatives to self-regulation other groups have. Otherwise, our rights as citizens and members would be really at risk. So I would put it that way. I would say that this is not a statist position, but rather it's an argument for responsible, accountable and it's not, again, you know, it's true that, as Courtney says, the book doesn't go into any particular religious discourse, but it reminds us that we're talking about, these are not domains free of power, or hierarchy, or domination. So, insofar as it is not about, insofar as the questions and issues are about that, we have to have public, and reflexive law doesn't mean top-down, intrusive regulation of the sort that most people think of it. It means a regulation of self-regulation. Okay, I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much. Can I ask one question? There with white glasses.
Thank you.
I'm going to move a mic around. And I will bundle a few questions. And then maybe give the panel a chance to respond selectively.
First of all, thank you. I humbly don't think there are any more pressing issues facing humankind before technologies of violence and solve these issues for us. I wonder, do any of you have a functional distinction between religion and superstition and religion and propaganda?
Thank you. So we've got two
in front here. I have one very, very basic
question. Can we just wait for a second until the mic arrives? It's so much easier to hear everyone.
One basic question or problem, whatever you would like to call it. I don't remember how old I was when they inserted Under God into the Pledge of Allegiance. To me, that is not secular, and frankly, I don't say it anymore, the Pledge of Allegiance, don't stand on anything. Am I alone in thinking this is definitely not freedom from religion in this country?
My question would be regarding the Christianity and the fact that ever since the post-Magna Carta era, Magna Carta era, the religion, the Christianity has never been pressured as it was during the 20th century under Nazism, fascism, and communism. So, are the current Western political and economical system really a threat for theocracy and the church? As the Pope spoke about it, many cardinals are for short and dual citizens as well. Thank you.
Gentleman at the back here, for sure.
Hello, thanks for your talk. I have one question. How can there be a meaningful protection of minority interests from the majority religious interests if the majority always resorts back to religious argument? For example, you can see right now in the arguments against for incompatibility of the Muslim values and the Christian values, when society falls back to no one's going to church, no one's Christian, but as soon as there's an out-group, everyone says like they're different, they don't fit our Christian society, our Christian values. Mm-hmm. How can we say that we're a secular state when like the dominant majority portion of the society still bears the values on Christianity, and through that discriminates other minorities with other religions?
Well, they have a provocative range of issues there. Pleasure allegiance, superstition, totalitarianism, and sort of New York majoritarian reflexes. What was the plenty of evidence of in Europe at this point?
I'll start, but people can also.
Absolutely.
I have no functional distinction between religion. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Between religion and superstition. Usually, one religion says it about other religions, which is similar enough, but I don't enter into that game. As for religion and propaganda, well, I mean, it depends on who's doing the propaganda. So, I don't know. I mean, this is not something maybe there's lots of propaganda that is religious, and there's lots of. Oh, I'll leave it at that. Yeah, in the 50s, the pledge at, under God was added, and then I think it was on the coins. I always mix up. It was at the end of the 19th century that the In God We Trust was put on, I guess it was the bills, and then in the coins in the 50s, or maybe it was reversed. I mixed the two of them up. Very often in a crisis, the Americans add religion to one of their public. Things. So I agree with you that this is not something that a secular state would normally do, but I didn't say America is secular in that way or secular enough. I mean, the battle is out. I was talking about basically the structure of the Constitution, but the battleground is precisely over what kind of public articulations of religion are acceptable or not, and so.
But that's forced on children, on everybody.
Yeah. As for protecting minorities, it sounds as if, I'm not quite sure what you're arguing, but the idea of political secularism is that the state isn't theirs. In other words, it's not Christian, the state doesn't belong to Christians, doesn't belong to Muslims, doesn't belong to Islam, Hindus, doesn't belong to Jews, it doesn't belong to anyone in particular. And therefore, it should be that all of our forces that protect individuals and minorities, or that should protect them, whether they would be administrative law or courts or legislatures, should do their job. That's what I would say. I don't find anything particularly distinctive of discrimination against, let's say, religious minorities as opposed to racial minorities, or as opposed to gender. They're not minorities. I mean, women are a minority, but I don't see anything distinctive in that. I think that basically discrimination on those bases should not be permitted.
Do we have other responses?
I think the question in the back, that is fundamentally the purpose of the text, and that is the question that is posed by almost, I think, every single one of the contributors. What are the appropriate mechanisms by which minority rights can be secured? The more difficult question concerns, I think, what will constitute the proper locus and the vehicle for representing those rights that are to be granted recognition as minority rights. That is it a communalist proposal in India? There are arguments that say, well, religions do constitute the last level at which the question of the minority can be asked. And then, of course, the other arguments that arise within those communities, children, women, people of sexually ulterior identities, and so forth, where do they fit vis-a-vis that sort of nested and overlapping set of demands for the security of various rights. But that, I mean, I think you should read the book. It seems to me that the question of education, though, is the reason it's a problem is because, you know, to use an old deconstructionist term, I mean, the pharmacologic of this milieu is that, according to certain democratic principles, in which everyone is treated equally, you assume that everyone assumes the value of equality, and that is not the case. I think that is the real that is really the vexing question. Not everyone avows equality as a good to be pursued. That's where we confront the epistemic and the political gaps between different traditions, and that will, you can't just pretend that isn't there.
Jim.
Grouping the two points here in the middle. I don't think totalitarianism posed a unique threat to Christianity or to religion, a threat of a difference in kind than other forms of state capture. I think that was largely a piece of ideology promulgated by its enemies. The German Lutheran Church was perfectly happy to cooperate with the Nazi regime, and Stalinism eventually reincorporated the Orthodox Church with its operations. That relates to the one nation under God question. I don't think the appearance of one nation under God in the Pledge of Allegiance or on our money makes America a religious nation. It makes America, like most nations, happy to co-opt certain religious rhetoric and values. I think in general, those sorts of co-options are really much more injurious, or should be understood as much more injurious to religious believers who are concerned about the idolatry of the state than they should be to secular people. One last point on the worry about how can nation states with religious majorities protect minority rights. I mean, I think Jean gave the sufficient and standard answer from a constitutional framework. I would just note that I think that answer, which is that majorities will protect minorities because the majoritarian, the institutions that the majorities create in a constitutional democracy will endogenize these principles of minority protection, does get back to this issue, which I don't think is a normative issue so much as it is an ontological one, of the ways in which public power or the state, or however you call it, is actually constituting people. Because it seems to me that the constitutional claim for minority protection rests on the idea that the citizens in a democracy can be transformed in such a way that they will not engage in discrimination against minorities. And to me, that seems like an ontological premise.
Do we have other questions? We do. Excellent. So, is the mic moving? Where is the mic? So we've got the lady behind you with glasses, and then gentleman here also.
Question on this last
map. Is this my mom? Close to the mic, please.
On this last question about the majority, the liberal democratic state, protecting the rights of the minority, it avoids the question of the problem of certain practices in some majority religions that may be antithetical to some of the fundamental principles of the majority democratic liberal constitutional state. One example we've been reading it so frequently lately, namely some of the practices in some Muslim or South Asian societies in which women are viciously abused on questions relating to choice in marriage or work.
Yeah, here's a contemporary question. The Iowa caucuses are going on tonight. There's an awful lot of evangelicals in Iowa who are firmly of the view that the federal government is hostile to their form of religious expression. And code phrases like political correctness are used really not in reference to what's going on at Yale or, Harvard, but in terms of school prayer, in terms of hiring practices, tax exemption, a range of issues these evangelical groups feel threatened. And I'm just curious how you respond. They're worried about being obliged to hire, religious figures. They're worried about, this is not my political position, of a church or the gay minister. But I'm just pointing out that these are issues that are being discussed today, and I'm just wondering tonight, I'm just wondering how you respond. I should maybe, in effect, beaten into submission from their point of view. Just to put a fine point on it, because I do think that's an issue that a fair number of Iowans are debating right now.
Another question.
If not, then I'll after this, use my position as the chair to add one final question, and then we'll do a last round of responses to wrap things up, so we have a reception afterwards. It kind of draws immediately on what you were saying here, because I see a lot in this book about constitutionalism. I didn't see that much about democracy, either with regard, as it were, to the constitution of the political people, which was a subject you were touching on with this issue of nationalism, but perhaps also in more specialised senses of the constitution of constituencies. There's one fascinating moment where you say the entire problematic of religion in America today is shaped by the southern strategy of the Republican Party. As it were, a strategy. I think the song you mentioned it.
That's right.
Yeah, and there's a sense in which, as it were, this isn't a matter of, as it were, anthropological givens or even sociology, but in some sense the contingent construction of salient political constituencies by strategizing of various types, which is not something one can legislate for or would want to legislate for in a liberal constitution, but nevertheless has enormous explosive potential, and one doesn't need to take a truly apocalyptic view of India. It's totally disagree with the account of India provided in this really astonishing, the apologetic chapter in the volume, which presents India as some sort of model of pluralism achieved and manages to avoid the fact that there are very few societies in the 20th century in which more people have been killed or were killed on religious grounds than the Indian case. And that is, in that case, attributed, I think, to the after effects of colonialism, which I think, with respect, is an inadequate explanation. There's another element of this, though, not so much at the level of the demos and the population, but also at the level of rule. And I mean, not as it were, that of judges in the constitutions, but if you like, the executive branch, action inspired by religion. And again, there are a number of really striking examples. The most notorious is perhaps the Bush and Blair pre-ins, where guidance is sought on issues of foreign policy driven by immediate references, respectively, to Catholicism and to evangelical religion. But it seems to me that those are elements which are difficult, perhaps, to theorise, because they are not ordering. By definition, they're, as it were, the contingent and open element in a democratic process. And yet, insofar as we're talking about the real existing problems of religion and modern democracy, those may trump all of the constitutional issues. The violent rhetoric of Le Pen, the utterly irresponsible populism of much of the American right, drives and explodes any amount of sophisticated jurisprudence or sophisticated constitution making. And that then requires another set of questions about what sorts of constitutions and what sorts of political cultures drive towards the containment of that. Is it, for instance, a matter of public broadcasting and the role of various types of public broadcasting in limiting the range of debate in some countries as opposed to others? And which sorts of constitutions leave that wide open as just a battlefield? So that, for me, would be a way of, as it were, taking that and binding it back towards the key terms of the volume.
Well, I mean, I don't think no legal form can prevent this or contrary to it. So I think we should understand the limits of one, the limits even of what a constitution can do. That's the first point. But the second point is that there are better and worse forms of design and also of, civic ethics and legal approaches. Now, with respect to India, my feeling was that one of the, again, I'm not a scholar of India, but for me, one of the terrible things, many people say it had to be done, but for me, one of the worst, or one of the most problematic dimensions of the Indian constitution was that it did not articulate a uniform civil code. It put it under the direct principles, and it's supposed to happen later. It never did. So it actually institutionalized religious status through pluralism. These were socialists and secularists making the constitution. But they did it because they had to partition with Pakistan, and they were worried about the Muslim minority. I understand all that, but nevertheless, it has queered the pitch from then on. So I guess one of my gut feelings is that legally institutionalizing segmented pluralism of any sort, whether it's ethnic or religious or tribal. Legally, I don't mean, again, I'm thinking of, like this, but legally institutionalizing that in such a way that the various groups are really under different law that is then enforced by the state is, I think that's a disastrous way to go. I think that undermines, not homogeneity, it enforces homogeneity within each group actually, but it undermines cross-cutting solidarities, it undermines a sense of being part of a whole. That doesn't have to be understood in a homogeneous way. I mean, New York, I don't think anybody thinks New York would be homogeneous, but we're all full of New Yorkers. But in other words, so that's like a ground position of mine. As for the Iowa caucuses, you know, it's, I think the cultural wars are still being fought out on the 60s. We have not gotten past them, number one. Number two, you know, there are powerful factions out there. For me, I'm always, again, maybe Courtney has another view on this. I'm sure she does. I'm always baffled at the thought that Christians in the United States take on the mantle of being discriminated against minority. I find that astounding. The idea that they're somehow silenced or privatized or kept, I mean, the First Amendment is not about conscience. Sorry for Sabah Mahmoud's, I think, misleading discussion about this. It's about free exercise. So religious freedom in this country has never been reduced to the right to think what you want or the freedom of conscience, number one. Number two, I don't see the restriction of religious free exercise that, sorry for the pun, exercises some of these... at least the political entrepreneurs. I'm not going to target the religion or people who have faith. That's why I don't get into the religious superstition thing. That's not my concern. My concern is there are political entrepreneurs who are religious entrepreneurs and who engage in quite specific, well, I don't know if it's cynical, but who engage in, I think, extremely dangerous practices and rhetoric that they are you know taken up by political entrepreneurs like Trump, etc. I think it's very dangerous. I'll let other people
know. So just directly on that point, I do think I have a different position than Jean on that, but that's I think largely because I'm not a normative theorist. So as a sort of positive matter, why is, as you described it, why is there this political problem happening today? You know, there's this political event, which is that a lot of Christians in America are making these claims that they are being discriminated against, that they are being forced in various ways. I would say I think it is a problem. I think it has emerged as an event that people are dealing with, that political parties have to deal with, that government has to deal with. Not because these religious believers misunderstand what is happening to them. In other words, I do not think this is happening because they think they are being coerced, whereas they are not being coerced. I do not think it's a problem because they are being coerced, even though I think it is true they are being coerced. That would not be a sufficient explanation because everyone is coerced. All citizens in any sort of state, certainly a democratic state such as ours, are coerced in a huge variety of ways. There are whole sets of beliefs that have been taken off the table for us by negative determinism of our upbringing, of law, of society, of education. So what makes it, I think, a problem, what makes it sticky, what makes their position sticky, and this is where maybe we get into what is religion, is they hold their beliefs more strongly than they have a certain internal point of view to a set of beliefs that I think is empirically more intense than other people's beliefs. So when they notice that, oh, we're citizens of a democracy and we're being coerced, they're particularly outraged by it.
I wanted to say really briefly, you know, I don't know if you read the piece that Eyal wrote in The Guardian some weeks ago in which he said that we have been misnaming the phenomenon of radical Islam. It's not been a radicalization of Islam at all. One can speak about the Islamization of forms of radicalism. And then those radicalisms, which were previously sites of very intensive subjective investment, and the
the modalities to which people made claims for social transformation, made claims on social justice, economic redistribution, whatever the case may be. I mean, I think I'm actually quite persuaded by that, and a lot of colleagues that I know who work in the Islamic world agree, but it was a supplement that one can speak about the religification of radicalism, and that tells us a great deal about this moment, both about the status of youth, the kind of the idea of the proper targets for radical disavowal, and it leads, I think, it's a very demanding question that it leaves us with about why that is, because simultaneously, of course, this religification of radicalism is rarely also directed at the forms of capital and so forth, that another kind of radicalism might have articulated. I don't agree at all that there's a relative intensity to the attachments organized by religion. You know, I think if you hung out with kids in Occupy Wall Street, one of the interesting things about that movement, which has failed in so many, many ways, but nonetheless, the experience of that kind of subjective intensification of a relationship to the idea of the social was very, very powerful, and I think it is true. The question is, who mobilizes it, when, around what projects, and why does a different kind of ambition for social justice and transformative politics outside of or in some kind of distance relation from the liberal democratic apparatus. Why does it go there? First of all, it wants to be inside the liberal democratic apparatus. It wants electoral power. It's not like other movements that wanted none. It wants to be inside of power. And it wants to use that instrument in that way.
Okay, I'll try to be extremely brief. Just to the point about how you protect minority religions in the majority. Just a clarification for Jean's comment. So the point was the suggestion of minority legal orders and cultural voluntarism, which is the idea that you have a choice between a single option and various religious options. Not because I'm Israeli. I mean, maybe it was running in my blood, but Israel does not really look like that. And all the examples that I was using are taken from the book. So I think it's part of the argument in the book. And they're all taken from the UK. Yeah? They're all taken from the UK. And sort of I would say my preference for them is pragmatic. They are a form of, if you will, sort of Obamacare. A robust public option and a lot of choice on the margins. And the value of that is you can get the value of that if you think about a case that is mentioned in two of the articles, which is the case of religious divorce in Muslim and Orthodox Jewish communities. You can legislate it as much as you want. You can, you can try to impose certain equality, gender equality, and I agree that the goal, maybe a long time from now, is gender equality. But how are you going to achieve it? In the case of religious divorce, if the woman still wants to marry within the community, then there's no other way but to go through the institutions that have been created. And so you need to influence the institutions, and you need to influence the people that are within those institutions. You need to create channels. You don't create channels if they feel under attack, they feel under threat, as in, in Iowa. You create channels. One way, indeed, is if you have this sort of robust public option plus choice.